Ladies and gentlemen, please, a big round of applause for Ms. Ron Elwani, Mr. Frank Fredericks, and Mr. Frederick Monnier. Once again, ladies and gentlemen, can we give it up for our three Olympians?
I think, Mr. Fredericks, we promised the audience that you would perhaps do a catwalk for them in your sexy shorts. So, ladies and gentlemen, if you would like to see Mr. Frank Fredericks model his sexy shorts, give him a round of applause.
All right, once again, ladies and gentlemen, we have Ms. Rani Alwani, Mr. Frank Fredericks, and Mr. Frederick Money. A great honor to have them here in Singapore talking to all of us. But right now, we have a little bit of a presentation about our three Olympians right now.
First up, we have Ms. Rania Alwani. She is a three-time Olympian. She is a nine-time medalist in the 1991 African Games at just 13 years old. She is also an Egyptian record holder for seven events. She is a multiple medalist at World Cup and World Championships. She won 11 gold and 1 silver medal at 12 events at the 97 Arab Games. She is also Egypt's Athlete of the Year for 10 years in a row. Ladies and gentlemen, up next we have a video of Rania Alwani at the 2000 Olympics.
That was Ms. Rania Alwani, 2000 Olympics. Right now, we'll move on to Mr. Frank Fredericks. Mr. Sexy Legs Frank Fredericks. He's the first ever Namibian to win an Olympic medal. And he's a three-time Olympian, bagging 4 Olympic silvers along the way. A round of applause once again, Mr. Frank Fredericks. He's the one who broke the world record for the indoor 200 meters at just 29 years old. He bagged the gold medal in the 200 meters world record at the 94 Commonwealth Games, and he started the very prestigious, very honorable Frank Fredericks Foundation. Now we also have a video of Mr. Frank Fredericks over in the Olympics, 92 in Barcelona and 96 in Atlanta.
Up next, we have Mr. Frederick Mane. He is a 4-time Olympian. He is also a 7-time gold medalist at World Championships. In fact, he broke the 2-year winning streak in the Keirin to win a World Track Championships title. He is also a World Cycling Centre director, and he oversees worldwide coach education programs. Up next, we have a video of him at the Sydney 2000 Games.
Great stuff, great stuff. Big fans in the house today. Now, of course, you guys are all accomplished Olympians, more than 2 times, 3 times Olympians. I must ask, though, what would be your best Olympic memory? What's the best thing that you remember about competing in the Olympics? Frank, maybe you want to start with you?
I think for me, it's for 12 days or for the duration of the Olympic Games, that everybody staying in the Olympic Village, we all equal. We all eat the same food. We eat, we sleep at the same places. And for just for the duration of the Olympic Games, we all the same. You see the powerful nations, you see the poor, you see the rich, we all together. And I think for me, that is a powerful, powerful message that we can send, that it doesn't matter whether you're rich or poor, when you come to these events, we all equal. And I think for me, going to the Olympic Games and seeing Steffi Graf and Andre Agassi and the great tennis players staying in the same village that I'm staying, because in your mind you're thinking that, you know, some people are different. And I think for me that was the beauty, and I think I will always treasure it, being in Barcelona.
Very cool. Equality at the Olympics. Miss Elwani, what about you? What about your best Olympic memory?
For me, it's almost the same, but also it's the friendships. Maybe I started going, my first Olympic Games was in 92. I considered myself a stranger. I was the only swimmer there. I had another swimmer from Egypt, but two swimmers from a country, you felt so lonely. So by 2000, I had people cheering for me from the US team, from the Slovakian team, everyone that I've trained with. So you become a big family. It doesn't matter what country you come from. So it really, it's the friendships that you gain along the years.
Friendship. And Mr. Monnier, what about your Olympic memory?
For me, the biggest impression was, of course, the opening ceremony and all of the flag with all of the countries. I think it's something very emotional, and like everybody, I think this is a fact to be multidiscipline, multi-sport, everybody together for 2 weeks, and opening and closing ceremonies. This is something amazing to feel and to be from inside. So, I think this is the best memory that I can have in the Olympics.
Very cool. I remember our Olympic opening ceremony as well.
So, Miss Elwani, tell us, how did you prepare for the African Games when you were just 13 years old?
I was asked that question earlier today, and it really, it didn't hit me that much. I was just a young swimmer that was chosen by the national team to represent the country. And for me, I was just very excited. I was the youngest on the team, so they put me to bed every night very early, and they went out to party. So that was the only thing that got me really mad. But other than that, I was very protected all the time. They took care of me, and I was very honored just to be part of the team. I wasn't scared, which is really weird, because I felt like there was no pressure. I was here to compete, and I didn't think I was going to win. So I ended up winning, but I thought it was just coming along for the trip. So it was fun.
Right, fun times at the Olympics. Mr. Frank Fredericks, I don't know whether some of you know, but he went on a scholarship to the States at Brigham Young University, and of course you trained there in the United States. My question is, how different is it between your training back home in Namibia and your stint in the States?
I mean, I think now it's not that much different, because I think Namibia have moved up to be a force to be reckoned with. But I think when I went to America, it was 1986. You have to understand that Namibia was also under the sports boycott together with South Africa, so we could not compete internationally. So for me, as a youngster, it was an opportunity to further my sports. But I had to compete for a U.S. university, but I could not say where I was from, because then the other countries would not compete against me. But I think that was political. But for me, it was a great opportunity to be able to go to a place where I could, you know, I could run on a weekly basis, and it gave me the opportunity to really realize what a talent I've received. You have to understand that as you sit here, you are probably the best youth in the world, and that's why you have a chance to compete here. So I think, you know, for me, if we had that, I would have had a chance to come to the Youth Olympic Games, and who knows what could have happened. So I think you need to realize as youngsters that the sky is the limit. You are the best of the best in your countries and also in the world. So I think you have to really make use of this opportunity to make sure, like Rania have said, to make friends, and in the process of making friends, to make sure that you compete well, so that you are proud when you go home and know that you have done your best. And also to make sure that you go through the culture and education program. But I think for me, just going to America was a cultural, a total cultural change. And I'm glad that I had the opportunity to do that.
Thank you, Mr. Fredericks. Okay, right now we are opening up questions to the floor. So if you guys have a question, please raise your hand in the air. Our mic runners will go up to you. Please introduce yourself and ask a question.
I would like to ask three of them. You were Olympians at a very young age. How did you manage to organize your time with your school, with your personal life, and with your training, or with your time? It's a little difficult.
Mr. Frederick, maybe you would like to answer the question first?
Yes, so I've been lucky probably because France is quite a big country and I have a well-developed structure for the sports. So as soon as you about 15 or 16 years old, you can enter to national sports schools like based in Paris, and they take care of your education, and of course you have coaches for you. So I guess I've been very lucky to manage the both education and training at the same time. And even for the, I think French for that, it's really well advanced. And I think I've been lucky to be in the right place, in the right moment, to develop my passion and to develop my my sports and my sport was good.
Ms. Elwani?
For me, it was a little different. I had parents who believed that sport was as important as education. Not less important. So I was very encouraged to train as well as to study. I had to leave my country. I was in medical school in Egypt, and I went to the States for 5 years to study. But it was it was essentially to be able to compete at a college level so that your swimming is or your sport is not jeopardized by your school. So I did both there, and it was successful for me as well.
Thank you very much. Mr. Fredericks?
Yeah, it's a very difficult question because it depends which country you're from. I remember, I think the French have probably one of the best systems. The US also have a very good system. But if you're in other countries, it is very difficult. What we're currently doing now with the IOC Athletes Commission is we want to find some athlete-friendly structures so that it is possible to do your sports and also to get the education. Because most of us realize that is the most critical thing for us is once you stop. For instance, I stopped in 2004. From one day to the other, you go from an Olympic champion to just an ordinary guy that needs to find a job. And if you have competed for 20 years for your country and you do not have the educational background, it will be very difficult for you to start or integrate yourself into life after sports. So it is something that we have realized at the Athletes Commission, of which Rania is also a member, that it is the most critical thing for us to work on. So we are busy trying to find structures, trying to find ways how we can make the lives of the Olympians a lot easier. You guys are lucky, because within this Olympic Village, you will have all these different people. You will have the IOC Athletes Career Program here, somebody that can already prepare you for a life after sports. So you are young. It will not be an easy path. If I have to tell you my story, I had to study, wake up at 4 or 5 in the morning to make sure I have enough time to study, to prepare myself. And then I have to go to school, university. After university, I go to classes. After classes, I go training. And then afterwards, you're too tired to do anything. But you still have 24 hours in a day. And I think you have to really learn at this young age how to prioritize things and to remember that it is critical for you also to get an education. Because if you do not get that education, it will be very, very difficult for you afterwards, even if you're an Olympic champion, even if you're the best athlete in the world. At the end of the day, if you come to my company and you want a job, I ask you what educational background do you have. I'm not asking about what medal you have won. We can use the medal to advertise that, but it is critical that you understand as young athletes to make sure that you also take the time to get your education. It will be difficult, but remember, if we did it, I mean, Rania was a medical doctor. I got an MBA. So if we could have done it and still get 4 silver medals at the Olympic Games, then it is possible to do it. So, make sure that you get that education. It will be tough, but but give yourself, prioritize, and make sure that you get it.
Truly inspirational stuff there, balancing education and sport excellently. Can we have another question from the crowd? I'm sure we have tons of things to ask these athletes. Anyone has a question? Yes. Can we have the young lady in the purple shirt?
Good evening. I'm Grace from Singapore. I'd like to ask the three Olympians, what makes you motivated and how do you keep yourself motivated from in hard times? Yeah, thank you.
So what is your greatest motivation throughout all the struggles and obstacles that you have gone through? Can we start with Ms. Elwani?
Okay. it really depends on the times. She said hard times, though, but sometimes your motivation is not to reach those hard times. Sometimes you've had really bad competitions that you remember and you don't want to go through this again. So your motivation in practice is to keep going and keep succeeding in what you're doing at practice every day so that you don't feel those feelings again. Other motivations were just representing your country, making the next cut for the next competition. It was just small steps. For me, it was just to try to be the best at everything I was doing daily. It doesn't really have to be just sport. Maybe taking care of a family member or studying well for the next exam. It really didn't matter what it was, but you have to be to try to be your best at everything you do every day.
Thank you, Ms. Elwani. I think Mr. Frederick Mane, would you like to tell us what is your motivation for getting so far?
The motivation was a passion, of the sport, passion of the training, passion of to do what you're able to love every day. Like I think to go training for 15 years, I never feel like I have to do something, then I have to push myself. So I think if you take pleasure, if you have the passion, it's easy and it's such a big dream to develop and to go somewhere in a place where you want to do. And I think for that, it's incredible. It's a fantastic experience.
Thank you. And I think passion is definitely one of the big reasons as to why these athletes are sitting here right now. So, Mr. Frank Fredericks, would you like to share with us what is your greatest motivation so far?
Yeah, I mean, I take it in a stride. I mean, I think, I'm still dreaming that I've done all these wonderful things because life has been really wonderful. To be able at a young age to realize what your dream is, what your talent is, while other people are searching, for me, it is probably the greatest thing. And when you have an obstacle that it faces you, for me, it is something that brings me down to earth. I realize that there are, I need to reach higher heights because, I mean, it's just for me that it's a way of being taught that, you are not the greatest yet. So train hard, make sure that you become better, and hopefully you can you can even get better. Because you have to understand, each one of us sitting in this room have obstacles. Each one of us in this room have something that you want to do but you cannot do. So I think you have to understand, everybody in life have obstacles. It is what we do with those obstacles that define us. You know, it's like, if I take the athletic program now, we have an A final, we have a B final. So if you're in the B final, it is what, maybe you have not run your best race, but it is what you do with the situation. You can just say, okay, I didn't run well early in the week, so I'm just going to forget the rest of the week. But then you will have even a horrible time in the B final. While you can say that, I have another opportunity, I have another chance, so let me grab this chance and do better than what I did previously. So I think in life, you will always have these obstacles, but it is what you do with these obstacles that will define you, whether you want going to become a winner or whether you're just going to be another number in this world. So I think that is, for me, is how I dealt with my obstacles and my demons, as I call them.
Can we have any more questions from the audience? Do you have any? Yes, young lady over there in blue. Just hold on, we'll have the mic over.
Please state your name, your NOC, as well as the sports that you play.
Hi, I'm Samantha Cash, and I'm from USA Volleyball. And I noticed that when you guys were talking about balancing your life, you never mentioned a social life. Do you feel like conflicted or looking back thinking, I wish I had more of a social life, or are you happy with choosing athletics?
Oh. Are you directing it to all three?
Yeah.
Okay. We'll start with Mr. Frederick Monnier. Maybe you want to talk about how you balanced your social life when you were training for your Olympics and your championships.
I consider sports as to be part of your social life. So I would think that to go on that way, it was something to do beside education and something to develop yourself. And I will say as social, you can have culture, of course. But I think the most important is you get the opportunity to discover some different culture, to travel. So of course, when beside the competition, you can have the time to see some other things. And in terms of development, I would say that without sports and my own experience, I don't think I will be able to do that ever in my life, because I was coming from a very countryside in France, and give me the opportunity, the chance to discover the world when I was I went at the Olympic. I was 18, and I was at Seoul. Never can happen that. So I guess on that part, feel pretty lucky to be on sport and to manage social life, and of course your passion, like I said previously.
Ms. Elwani, maybe you'd like to share your end of the story?
Sure. I think social life maybe becomes your team more than anything else. You do a lot of things with your friends outside your team, but on the weekend. But trust me, we had a better or a more productive social life as athletes than when we do now when we're working. It becomes harder and harder. I mean, you don't have much time after you retire. So being a part of a team and competing together and traveling together and having weekends where, yes, they are the closest people to you. They're the people who understand you the most. They go through the same things every day. So they understand you the most. You want to hang out with them more often than you do with your school friends, for example. Family is just people you get together with on the weekend or in occasions. And I really wish I had that much time like we did when we were competing. I don't have that much time for social life as I do now, as of today, as these days, as I did before. So you can enjoy everything, I'm sure, if you prioritize, like Frankie said, and if you give time that is suitable for everything, for your schoolwork, for your friends, for your family, and for your sport as well.
So, Mr. Fredericks, did you have a social life?
Very good question. I think, I mean, what is important is you need to understand that if you are hanging around the same people, I'm saying if you are hanging around the same crowd that we have here, all driven with the ideals of sports, then you will not feel guilty on a Friday night to say that at 10 o'clock or 9 o'clock or 11 o'clock that I'm going home. Because they understand that the next day you might have a training session or not. But if you're hanging with a crowd where sports, waking up early in the morning for training, is not in their vocabulary, then you will start feeling guilty that, how do I say I want to go home? Do I blame my parents? Do you understand? Because you have peer pressure because you don't know what to tell them. And for me, I just say, I'm going home. The friends will not like it, but you will always have a chance to make better friends that have your values in mind, that have the same, that appreciate you. Because, I mean, you know, I had many guys that will say, Frankie, here's a beer. Frankie, here's a glass of wine. Frankie, here's a whatever. I said, no, I don't drink. I don't want it. And if they insist, it means they are not my true friends. Because true friends respect each other. And if you say no, they say, okay. He says no because he understands that it's probably not something for him. But if you have friends that force you in doing something that you don't want to do, then I think you have trouble. And my motto in life was, if I have to do something and I have to ask myself, what will my mother say in this case? You have to understand, for us Africans, you know, we are scared of our mothers. Our fathers are okay, but our mothers, we are scared of our mothers. So, you know, for me, I had to ask myself, you know, if I see somebody drinking a beer or alcohol and I want to drink it, I have to ask myself, what will my mom say? And if the question is, the answer is, hell no, get out of it, then you know you're in trouble. And that's the questions I ask myself. And that was my guiding light through life. And so I think for me, you know, and I think I lost a lot of friends that would come back after I come home with the medals and say, we used to be friends. I say, yes, we used to be friends. Because you did something that you don't deserve my friendship. You have to earn somebody's friendship. But I can tell you, through sports, I've made better friends than the ones I've lost.
Now we know, always ask ourselves, what would my mother say? Okay, do we have any more questions from the floor? I think we'll take one.
I think we'll take this, Mayor, because you raised it. Yes, can we have the young man in front here?
Please state your name, NOC, as well as the sport that you play. Je parle
en français. French. Bonsoir à tous. Donc, je m'appelle Faisal Ben Daoud. Je suis des Comoriens. Je présente les Comoriens. D'ailleurs, je suis l'entraîneur d'athlétisme de la jeunesse. Bon, avant, j'étais un athlète des Comores international, pas mal. Donc, j'ai participé à deux Jeux Olympiques. J'étais à Atlanta, j'étais à Sydney. Bon, j'ai été africain. Avant, il y a des athlètes mondiaux qui prend le médicament, ça s'appelle bon, antidopage. Est-ce qu'il y a du message pour les athlètes mondiaux maintenant pour alerter, pour prendre le médicament pour l'antidopage? Voilà. C'est ma question.
Right, so the question, first one was the issue of doping in sport.
As a medical part. Yes, there is a lot of education going on. If you go to the WADA booth, you will have a lot of information about medication and what to use and what not to use. But the basic rule is do not take any medications unless you know exactly what's in it and you're prescribed to take it and your doctor knows what's on the list and what's not on the list. Make sure you check the list every year because it's a changing process. The list changes every September, October, and it's effective starting January, so you only have 2 to 3 months for the coaches and the doctors to review the list and see what additions or deletions have happened. And just, it's easier not to take anything. I think you're healthier when you take care of yourself, to eat well, stay healthy, and when you need something, I'm sure, the rules are not there to torture anyone. The rules are there to prevent anyone from cheating and to keep the health of the athletes. And we have to remember, doping is not just taking a performance-enhancing drug. It's also taking any drugs that would harm the health of the athlete or taking drugs that are considered not ethical or against the value of sport. So it's really protecting the integrity of the athletes. So just get the, there's a lot of material on the web, on the WADA website. I mean, the material is there. Therapeutic use exemptions are easy to get if you have the need for it. So if you're an athlete that's looking to be clean, you're okay. I think the bad news is for the rest.
Thank you, Ms. Elwani. Health is key, everyone. So, yes, we would like to take a question from that gentleman.
Sorry, Gloria, I think Mr. Frank Fredericks has something to add on.
Yeah, just one thing, and I just want to remind you guys that, you know, and I come back to life. In life, there is no shortcuts. You have to work hard to earn to be a champion. There is no shortcut. It's the same as with your school. You cannot go to school grade 1 and then in 2 years' time you're in grade 12. There is no shortcuts in life. So remember, you have to work hard. Maybe you will not achieve it the first time. Go back. Find out what you can do better with your coach, come back, but just remember, there is no shortcuts. And for me, drugs is a way of somebody trying to find a shortcut. And do not take away the glory of somebody else that could have done it in a clean way.
Thank you, Mr. Fredericks. That gentleman over there, it's okay. Do we have... Please state your name, your country, as well as the sports that you play.
Possible French?
Okay.
Ben, bonsoir à tous. Je m'appelle Amour Sofiane, je suis algérien. Je voulais demander aux trois champions de me décrire les sensations d'être au podium olympique et d'entendre l'hymne national devant des milliers de spectateurs.
Right, so for those who didn't catch it, the question is for all three champions. The question is, how is it like standing on the winner's podium at the Olympics and also hearing your national anthem being played? Mr. Frank Fredericks, maybe we'll start with you.
All I can say is the best feeling. I mean, I think it's the greatest feeling to know that 80,000 people in the stadium, they are all just focused on you at that moment, on your national anthem. And I think it's such a wonderful feeling. I mean, the first time I felt that was in Egypt in 91, when I won my first international medal at the All-African Games. And just to be there and to know that there's 60,000 people listening, and I think that the tears just came out. I mean, I don't even remember I had tears, you know, to cry from joy, but it was just such a great feeling, and a feeling that I think it's worth working and making the necessary sacrifices.
Salut, Sofiane. It's my turn.
Yes, it's your turn, Miss Alwani.
Zaik, Sofiane. You speak Arabic too?
Okay.
For me, actually, the only podium that I haven't been on is the Olympic Games, so I cannot describe the Olympic Games podium, but I suspect that it's just like any time you listen to your national anthem. For me, it was the same experience, but I was in a junior championships in Morocco, I think, and it was, or Zimbabwe, Junior African Games, and I remember also crying when I heard my national anthem. In 91 in African Games in Cairo, I remember crying because I didn't expect that many people calling my name because they're all Egyptians, so they were very happy that I was getting medals, so it was very biased. It really gives you a chill because you don't realize that you have that much effect on people, and you do. You have a lot of people watching you and a lot of people putting their hopes on you, and if it hits you before you compete, I don't think you'll get on those blocks, so I'm glad that we get it on the podium. It's a greatest feeling.
Thank you. And Mr. Manier, what about you? All your world championships, how did it feel like being on the winner's podium?
I think to be on the podium, this is a result and this is a pure pleasure. I think you just here because this is you've been awarding, you obviously win the race and be the first one, and the time passed so short, like the national anthem is something special, and when they put the flag on the top, it's something amazing to describe, and it's going so fast. You need to think about your friends, you need to think about your family who's going to supporting you all the way around, and they're in front of TV and probably share, probably physically don't be there with you, but they can share all of the happiness, all of the fruit of the result, the fruit of the work that you've been done, and you try to be on the top on that day. So I think it's too short, I would say, but this is a magic moment. I consider like being so lucky to describe that, and never I would say that it's something very, very special, and for all of people who's sharing your passion with you.
Yes, we have one young boy over there, right in the corner in white. Question from our SGI boy.
Hello, I'm Raj from SGI. I wanted to ask the three champions, what were the greatest obstacles that you faced on your Olympic journey?
I think for me, the greatest obstacle or the greatest pressure, I should say, I had was in 96. I think I did not lose any races that year. And coming to the Olympic Village, you know, I had so much pressure. I mean, even if I eat something and, you know, I drink water, it feels like the water don't taste like water, you know. I just had so much pressure. And I think that was, for me, it was the most difficult, because 92, being in my first Olympic Games, I was like you guys. was in the village partying and, you know, just wanted to do all the culture things. And, you know, it was not so serious. I went through the final, I got silver medals. In 96, everything was, you know, I was tense. If somebody say hello, I'm like, hello. Somebody says, you know, I was so tense, so nervous. And I think that was something that I did not enjoy as much as I should have. And I think that was something that I missed, and it's a difficult obstacle for me to think about and to overcome, because I could have probably run faster, I could have probably won a medal, but you don't want to say that. When you come to a games, you want to feel relaxed, enjoy it, like I said to you, because it's because I have things. Have fun, make friends, and enjoy life.
For me, it was having to make decisions early on when I was 17 that I was accepted in medical school in Egypt, but to continue my career, I didn't have very good competition for me in Egypt. I was number one in Egypt when I was 12 years old, so I didn't have much to compete with. I had to go outside the country to swim with some other people that can train better with me. So at 17, I had to leave medical school in Egypt, which is very hard to get into in Egypt, so I really had to convince my parents first. And then I went to the States for 5 years, and to retire at 23, I had also to decide, should I retire or live again in the United States so I can continue swimming? It was just about finding the right partners to train with, the right coaches, the right competitions, and it was hard to decide at those parts of my life, should I leave or come back? That's it.
Mr. Manu, what about you?
For me, the hardest was the last Olympic. It was in 2000. I decided a few years ago that I was going to stop in Sydney. And I think the pressure, like I've been not lucky compared to three Olympics in Seoul and never get a medal. So for me, it was the last sport, the last chance. And I think this is the Olympics is something very special. It's every 4 years. And this is, for me, it was exactly the last chance, the last sport to get a medal. And I knew that if I didn't get one, the history of the Olympics as a sportsman, to be an actor, was over. And I think it was the most difficult to handle. But to be positive, I was devastated after my final at the Olympic in Sydney, because I get six, still go to the final. But then I just want to share that with you. It helped me so much after for my future, because I think you can pass over a dream and you can pass over something that it really hurts you, but turn in a positive way and help you for the future. So here for you, I think you have to take experiences of your result, give the best performance, but every experience gives you the opportunity to develop yourself and to educate yourself for the future. You have the whole life in the front of you. So experience is fantastic. And this is why the Olympic journey was difficult, to go back on the question.
Thank you very much to our three Olympians. I'm sure we have a lot more questions, but unfortunately, we are currently running out of time in our session. Maybe you would like to pose one more question to our Olympians. What is the one thing that you want to tell the audience, our youth Olympians? You know, they're going to move on to the Summer Olympics as well in the future. What is the one message that you want to tell to these people? Because you guys have been there before. So what is the message that you have? Mr. Fredericks, maybe we'll start with you.
I've probably told you all my messages, but I think it is, for me, the most important is have fun, enjoy the ride, make sure that you make the best of this opportunity. Don't let it pass by. You're not going to be a youth again. In 4 years, you are going to be older than what you are. So make sure that you enjoy the ride. You make sure that you take the experiences that you gained here and make sure that you can, you know, take that forward and hopefully qualify for 2012 or 2016. So I think those would be the critical things. And what you should not forget is to make sure that you balance your education and your sports at the same time. Because we, as we are sitting here, we are facing a lot of problems with many Olympians that cannot even find a job. And they have won gold medals. So if it's difficult for them, just imagine how difficult it will be for the rest of the world. So I'm saying at this stage, make sure that you combine education and also sports at this level. So that would be my message.
Very Thank you. You said everything.
Combining education and sport. Miss Elwani, do you have anything to add to that?
Well, have fun and stay clean. Make sure that you're not involved with the doping, not from near or far, and make sure that you know what medications you take. I don't want to be boring, but stay clean is the message.
Stay clean from drugs. And finally, Mr. Monnier, what about you? Takeaway message for these Olympians?
I think what they did here, they already achieved, it's a great achievement to be here on that place. I mean, they were the best in their country, and they already moved forward in a big steps. And of course, it's to work, but the most important, it's to share things, to share friendships together, and to take, I think we have the same message, to take pleasure and just to watch every single moment that they have the chance to be here for more than 2 weeks and just enjoy.
Thank you very much to our Olympians, and they've given our takeaway message to our youngsters these days, and I'm sure they'll be proceeding into the Summer Olympics and breaking world records as well. Once again, can we have a round of applause for our athlete role models, Mr. Frank Fredericks, Ms. Rania Elwani, and Mr. Frederick Monnier.